Recording in progress.
Recording in progress.
Testimony,
yeah. So I can attest to the goodness of God for your life.
Amen. And God is.
Yes, He is.
And His mercy and His grace certainly endures to all generations. We have Elder Robert Turner here with us today, and he'd like to come sit in the pulpit with us. We also, amen, were blessed, amen, to have, amen, a young lady that wants to christen her child today, amen, to ask God's blessing and give a baby to Christ. We've asked her to come forward with us. Reverend Johnson, come with us, amen, also. But come forward at this time. The mic, yeah. Amen. And all those who are going to be involved in the baby's life, amen, you can come also.
Amen.
God certainly is an awesome, wonderful God. Amen.
Yeah.
Allow us to privilege. Amen. Of faith, amen, to be saved, but it's a wonderful thing that they say to that child and saying to us, they want to put the child in position, amen, in an environment, amen, to know Jesus and the pardon of sin. State the baby's name, amen. Laquita Tyrone.
Zachary.
Zachary III, amen. And you allow him, amen, to come under the knowledge of Jesus Christ from your teaching and your living in his presence, right? In the book of Matthew, the 19th chapter, verse number 13, it says, "Then were there brought unto him little children, that he should put his hands on them and pray. And the disciples rebuked him." They complained about, amen, children being brought to Christ, amen, to be prayed for. But Jesus said, "Suffer little children and forbid them not to come unto me, for of such is the kingdom of heaven." And he laid his hands on them and departed them. The question I must ask, amen, is that you are going to, amen, have an environment for your child that the child may know Jesus Christ, your son, in the presence, amen. You would walk the life, talk the life, live the life in your son's presence. Is that correct? And all of the family members, amen, as he is in your presence, you're going to display Jesus Christ in your lives that the child may see a godly lifestyle and manifest that lifestyle in his life. Yes? Don't play, you know. We'll play with you. Don't fool you now. Don't be doing no cussing and fussing and cutting and stabbing and all of that stuff in front of the child and exhibiting bad behavior, amen, because children are what? Imitators, right?
Yeah, amen.
You know, imitators of what they see in the house, in the home and in what the neighborhood. You agree? So you present Zachary, amen, to the Lord, amen, in the name of Jesus Christ, and thereof. Amen. Let us bow. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you, we praise you, we magnify you. We give you the glory, Father, for your creation, Father. And we thank you, Father, for those who are created by you, Father, or receive and have received, Father, Jesus Christ, Father, as the Savior of their lives. We thank you for this mother, Father. We thank you for this family who have come forward and said that we are presenting Zachary, amen, to you, Father God, that we might be able, he may be able, Father, to see you in our lives, and that we're going to bring him up in the nurture and the admonition of the Lord.
Yes, Lord.
That he may understand and know about you, Father, until the time comes, Father, he himself, Father, be able to make the decision to give his life to you.
Yes,
Father God, we thank you, Father, for their desires. We thank you,
thank
for their
you, Lord. Yes, God.
We pray, Father, you bless little Zachary, Father, that you yes. build him up, Father, and strengthen him, Father, that he may understand, Father, that greater is he, Father,
yes.
that's within him, Father, that he that's in the world.
Mm-hmm.
And Father God, we pray that you would shower your grace and mercy upon him. Allow him to grow straight and strong, Father, and have an appetite and desire, Father, to be, Father, part of your body, in the name of Jesus Christ, is our prayer.
Yes, God.
We accept, amen, the offering that you offered today, your son. And we, the church, will try to set the example for
amen.
Him, amen, of godliness in our lives.
Yes, Lord.
Thank you so very much.
Amen.
You want to come up with us? Oh, you're good? Oh, okay. You want to sit with your family, amen. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Amen.
Amen. God is so good. He has blessed me. Amen. That I have the opportunity, amen, to, amen, have a break.
Oh.
Amen. A time and period that, amen, that I can kind of push back a little bit and listen, amen, to the word of God. But I thank God for this time of year, and I'm hoping, amen, that we understand and recognize the fact that what God has given us is greater than anything that you can find under a Christmas tree.
You're right.
Amen, amen.
He's greater than a gift card that promises things to come.
Yes.
Don't be a Christmas Christian. You only unwrap Jesus in December and forget about him in the months of the year.
Oh, no. That's true.
Share him every day in every way in your life, for he is the gift that keeps on giving.
Amen.
Am I right about that?
Amen.
Arthur Roy L. Kipp, put it this way, he shares with us this thought. He who has not Christmas in his heart will never find Christmas under a tree.
Well,
amen.
Am I right about that?
Amen.
So let's not just be Christmas Christians, amen. Let's serve him and shine his light in the world that we live in every day.
Amen.
And come on, Tracy, give us a song. Amen. And this morning, amen, my son in the ministry, amen, and the person of Lawrence Moody, we're bringing us the message of Christmas.
Thank you.
Merry Christmas. Christmas to everyone.
Merry Christmas.
Amen. This is a wonderful time of the year. Amen. Giving the honor to God, to our pastor, First Lady, to my beautiful wife, Christy. Please raise your hand. Amen. It's great to see my Uncle Robert, Elder Robert Turner here. Reverend Johnson, thank you for being a part of this service.
Amen.
Amen. I'm not going to hold everyone up, but this is a great blessing to be here. Amen. I want to kind of integrate what the pastor was saying last week, because that was an awesome program last Sunday.
Yeah. Man.
So we're going to go back into the book of Isaiah, the 9th chapter, verses 6 and 7.
Okay.
Amen. How's everybody doing today?
We're
doing
good. Praise the Lord. Thank you,
Jesus.
Isaiah 9 chapter verses 6 and 7. Amen. Are we ready? For unto us a child is born. Unto us a son is given. And the government will be upon his shoulder. And his name will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Verse 7 says, of the increase of his government and peace, there will be no end upon the throne of David and over his kingdom to order it and establish it with judgment and justice. From that time forward, even forever, the zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this.
Right.
And I want to talk to you about during while it's Christmas.
Okay.
He is the best gift when he comes back.
All right.
Now, we all know that Christmas is far more than giving and receiving. Even though we allow ourselves to get caught up in the hustle and the bustle of Christmas.
Yeah.
You see, we all understand something of the true meaning of Christmas.
Uh-huh.
You see, we know that Jesus was God in human flesh.
Uh-huh.
We know that when Jesus was born in Bethlehem, God stepped out of eternity and eternal time. And you know, we know that Jesus is a great teacher.
Come on.
He's a great healer.
Yeah.
And he's a miracle worker.
Yeah.
We know that Jesus came to the earth to die for our sins and on that cross.
Mm-hmm.
We know that he rose again from the dead and ascended back to the heaven to make intercession for his people and to prepare us for a place for us there.
Mm-hmm.
We know that the real gift of Christmas is Christ himself.
Amen, amen.
What we may not always think about, even at Christmas time, is the fact that some of the greatest gifts of Christmas have yet to be delivered.
Well,
you see, these gifts are not being delivered by the post office, by FedEx, by UPS, or even by Amazon. They will be delivered by the power and the authority of God.
Yes.
These gifts will come in his perfect time.
Uh-huh.
We may wonder, but they will come. And we have a lot of verses that cross-reference to Isaiah.
Come on.
Number one, we need to understand the gift of his arrival.
All right.
They make great claims concerning the Lord Jesus Christ of fulfilling when he came the first time.
Come on.
Isaiah says, for us, until a child is born, a
son is given. And you know, those that little part of that verse, it tells a lot about who Christ is.
Uh-huh.
When they talk about a child is born, he identifies himself as man.
Yeah, yeah.
The baby that Mary brought into this world long ago was fully human.
Yeah.
He knew all about pain.
Yes, he did.
He knew all about sorrow.
Yeah.
He knew all about loss. L-O-S-S. He knew about grief.
Yeah.
He knew about hunger.
Mm-hmm.
He knew about thirst.
Yeah.
He knew about weariness.
All right.
He knew about suffering.
Yeah.
We need to be reminded that the virgin birth incarnation, God Almighty, became human.
Yeah.
Huh?
Yeah.
When they talk about the Son is given, he identifies himself as God.
Yeah.
God did not come into this world a fully grown man.
Uh-huh.
He came as a helpless infant.
Yes.
But that baby was God.
Was God. You're right. You're right.
He was given so that we might be redeemed from our sins and born again into the family of God.
Uh-huh.
We know the truth.
Yeah.
We believe these truths.
Yeah.
We celebrate these truths.
Yeah.
The Bible makes it clear that God in human flesh is an absolute, indispensable foundation truth of our faith.
Yeah.
Without God being a man, the death and the resurrection of Christ means nothing. With its sacrifice, means nothing. It means the innocent died for the guilty, and the sinners cannot be saved. Can't be saved. It then will come to Jesus Christ by faith. The truth that Isaiah mentions after these first two phrases are gifts that have yet to be delivered. They were not fulfilled during the first coming.
No.
But they will be fulfilled when he comes back. And he is going to return. That is his promise. Look what John 14:33 says. He says, I will go and prepare a place for you. I will come again and receive you unto myself. Matthew's 25:31 says, when the Son of Man shall come into his glory and all the holy angels with him, then shall he sit upon the throne. Stick with me now. Revelations 1:7 says, he cometh with clouds, and every eye shall see him, and they also which pierce him, and all kindreds of the earth shall wail because of him, even so. Revelations 2:25 says, but that which you have already fast till I come. Revelations 22:2 says, behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me to give every man according as his works shall be. Revelations 3:11 says, behold, I come quickly, hold that fast which thou hast, no man that take thy crown. Revelations 16:15 says, behold, I came as a thief. Blessed is that watcheth and keepeth his garments. Revelations 22:7 says, behold, I quickly bless is he that keepeth the sayings of the prophecy of this book. Revelations 22:20 says, he that which testifieth, there is things saith, surely I come quickly. Even so, Lord Jesus Christ. Revelations, staying in this, 19:16 says, as he had on his vesture, on his thigh, a name written, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And that's pretty clear. the greatest gift of those which remain. Because when he comes, all the remaining gifts will flow out of this one.
That's right. All right.
Number two, we got to know the gift of his acknowledgement. Isaiah tells us again that when Christ comes, he will be given many titles.
That's true.
What do you mean by he is wonderful?
All right.
They're talking about the supernatural. They talk about the secret. That name, wonderful, points out the truth that there is nothing common about Jesus. He is the miracle man. He is far beyond the level of comprehension that we can never figure him out. He can be known by just a little child.
Come on.
He is wonderful in his words. He is wonderful in his works. He is wonderful in his way. He is our counselor, means to counsel, to advise, purpose, and he always devises a plan. It refers to the role as the leader, the guiding force of our lives. When they talk about he is the mighty God, Pastor, that means he is the hero. Refers to one who is strong and mighty and invincible. He is alone is worthy to be our hero who has defeated all of our enemies. He defeated death. He defeated sin.
The Lord of Lords and the Kings of Kings.
kings. That is the gift the world needs today. It is the one world will enjoy when he comes. The third part is he gave us the gift of advancement. Isaiah tells us that when the Lord comes, one of the gifts he will give the world will be his perfect reign as the King of Kings. He says in verse 7, and that government shall be upon his shoulder of his increase of the government, and the peace shall be no end upon the throne of David and upon his kingdom, and to order it and to establish it. When Jesus comes back, he will come back as king. That is the clear teaching of the scriptures. Revelations 12 and 5 says, she brought forth a man child who was ruler of all nations with a rod and an iron, and her child was caught up unto God and to his throne, which is referred. Revelations, stick with me if we back into Revelations, chapter 19, verses 15 through 16. And out of his mouth go a sharp sword that would it should smite the nations. And he shall rule them with a rod of iron, and he treadeth the winepress of the fierceness, wrath God Almighty. And he on his vesture, on thy the name written, King of Kings, Lord of Lords. Matthew's chapter 6, verses 9 through 10 says, the disciples were taught to pray for his kingdom after this manner. Therefore, pray of our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. Thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. He is coming, and when he does, he will establish the eternal kingdom. Then when we take a look at verse Psalms, the 145 number of Psalms, verses 10 through 13, all thy works shall praise, O Lord, and thy saints shall bless thee. They shall speak of the glory of thy kingdom and talk thy power. To make known the sons of men his mighty acts, glorious majesty of his kingdom. The kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and dominion enduring throughout all generations. Jeremiah, 23rd chapter. I told you it was going to be a lot of cross references. Verse 5 through 6. Behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that I will raise unto David a righteous branch, and a king shall reign and prosper, and shall execute judgment and justice in the earth. In his days, Judah shall be saved, and Israel shall safely, and this is his name, whereby he shall be called the Lord of righteousness. Then when it came to Luke, chapter 1, verses 32 and 33, he shall be great, and he shall be called the Son of the Highest. God shall give unto him the throne of David, and he shall reign over the house of Jacob. Forever of his kingdom there shall be no end. Then, what did Pilate ask Jesus in John 18 and 37? He said, are you a king? Jesus answered and said, rightly, that I am king. For this cause I was born. For this cause I had come into the world, that I should bear witness to the truth. Everyone who is of the truth hears my voice. Those are the words of Jesus. One day, the Lord Jesus will occupy the throne of David. righteousness, power, and glory. When he does, the world that will be will all know that he is king today. Yet the world does not acknowledge him, even in this time as king. We know that we must yield to the throne of our heart, him and his sovereign rule. His rule in the world today is in the arena of the redeemed hearts. So let me ask you this. Is Jesus the absolute ruler of your heart? Is he the absolute ruler of your life?
All right.
He should be.
That's right.
And if he isn't, we need to enthrone him today.
All right.
His reign as king will be a great gift to this world. The last part, and then I'll let you go. We need to acknowledge that he is the gift of his achievement. Once again, Isaiah tells us that the coming king will make rule with judgment and justice, and henceforth even forever. You see, it takes a simple glimpse at our world that to understand that this is a Christmas gift that has yet to be delivered. In the world, there is no peace. You got the United States of America and all the other countries. We have leaders that are not getting along. They are not getting along enough to transact the business that is in the best interest of people in this nation, in this world. There are many problems that we face in this world. You see, there is no peace as long as war, crime, hatred, racial tension, and all types of turmoil on every hand. The greatest Christmas gift, when Jesus was born in Bethlehem, wrapped in swaddling clothes, laying in the heart of a manger. When he was born, the angels rejoiced that Christ would bring peace to the world. Glory to the God in the highest on earth, peace, goodwill toward men. When he became man, he unstopped deaf ears. He gave sight to the blind. He healed the leper. He healed the sick. He became the greatest Christmas gift to all he was brought to try. He allowed mean men to curse at him. He allowed mean men to mock him. He allowed mean people to lure him to that old rugged cross. They pierced him in his side. They put nails in his hands, spikes in his feet. He laid in the locks of his shoulder, and he died. But he didn't stay dead long. When he laid there all day Friday. He laid there all day Saturday. But early Sunday morning, I just said, he defeated death. Got up with all power in his hands. And we all know that justice, peace, and perfect judgment have not been delivered to earth. But those things and more are coming. When Jesus comes to rule as king on earth, the world will be dominated by his peace, his justice, and his perfect judgment. Imagine a world that there is no war, no poverty, no injustice, no religious or racial differences. Imagine a world which every citizen worships God Almighty and bows to the Lord Jesus Christ. Imagine a world which in every ruling handled down from throne is perfect in the best interest of God and me. Can we picture that? Imagine a world that is marked by perfection, peace, and the very presence of God. Imagine a world which there is no iniquity, no mistreatment, no less fortunate, and the disabled. Imagine a world which there is no sickness, no deformed bodies or troubled minds, or death. Imagine a world where righteousness and holiness and peace are the ordinary course of life for all. And that is the world that Christ will create when he returns, ladies and gentlemen.
Yes.
When he comes, the curse of sin will be removed from the world. When he comes, the world will be restored to the beauty and the glory of the original creation. When he comes, Jesus will give the world everything. Everything that we need, and it would have if sin had not been entered in and destroyed everything. That's the world we are looking for. That's the world we should be hoping to live in. That this is the greatest Christmas gift that when it's given to all, when he comes. As I mentioned earlier, not all gifts have been delivered.
Right.
But they will be. When the Lord Jesus comes back to this world, he's going to come back in power and glory. He will give us everything we have been waiting for. When he comes, Christmas will actually be complete. So why would you think that would happen? Isaiah says in that last part in verse 7, he talks about the zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this. When they talk about zeal, it refers to an enthusiastic diligence. Means that the Lord will not quit, will not rest until he has everything accomplished in all those things. He will not rest until every promised gift of Christmas has been delivered. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you.
Praise the Lord. Amen. We thank God, amen, for that beautiful Christmas message.
Amen.
And Reverend Moody is telling us why Jesus came. Amen. Please, my brothers and sisters, let not Christmas just be a fleeting moment or one day.
Amen.
Let us have Christmas in our hearts. And when we have Christmas in our hearts, it shows the reverence and the deep appreciation for what God has done for us, what God has given us, what God is doing in our lives this very moment. See, God has saved us from the bondage and penalty of sin. God is saving us from sin in our daily life. And God will save us from the very presence of sin in the rapture of the church. Amen.
Yes, amen.
Be taken out of this place. So if you're here today, amen, and you're unsaved, this is a moment that you can come to Jesus.
Amen.
If you're here today and you are a shady Christian that's hiding your light, amen, under a shade and not shining bright, will you come while this number's being written? As we make preparation, amen, for the offertory here, and I want to thank some individuals, Sister Harper and Brother Harper, and their lovely granddaughter, Tracy.